She only divulged so much about what was going on in her mind. And that was the hard thing, that she put up those barriers. She had, in a sense, the strong black girl. She fulfilled that. You have to try and like always be strong, always be. You don't want to show any kind of weakness. Like, what's this, like, depression? What is that? Like, I think she felt like she had to be strong for herself, isn't it? That's it. She had to be strong for herself.
This is a podcast for Kel. That was Asaye, who was one of Kelly's closest friends during the period that we're going to talk about in this episode, which is Kel, around the age of 19 and 20. Looking back, this is a time when Kel started to come up against herself and encounter aspects of her personality that stopped her achieving her goals and which, later in life, would come to take her over. So how long were you with Kel for?
We met in 2012, in September 2012, at school together in East London, in this kind of fortuitous thing where we both weren't really meant to be there.
Kel had many lovers and boyfriends in her life, but when she talked about her serious relationships, there were only two. Both of them were with men called James, and so she called them James I and James II. Kel met James I within a few days of enrolling to do A-levels at Sixth Form College in 2012. It's just after she came here to live. She was 18. At the start, they were just friends. Their relationship wouldn't begin until the beginning of 2013. This is James, who's now 26.
And we were excited to be two people that kind of stood out to each other and, you know, catching each other's eye or whatever and going, oh yeah, why are you here? And finding out a story about each other and kind of going, oh, we have similar interests.
So what caught your eye about her?
I think it's really beautiful. Mm. It's really that simple. I remember in a lesson, I just remember noticing her properly. Like, we were in the same philosophy class, I think, same English class. And we basically took the same subjects, art subjects, and then we were here walking home and both interested in film and stuff like this. So it was like this weird thing where at the school maybe there weren't too many people like us and we would kind of be able to find our own personal space like immediately. That's quite a nice thing.
And what did you, and what were your films? What were the things that you spoke about and bonded about?
It's funny because it's like Woody Allen, isn't it?
Ironically.
But, Pedro Almodovar, surely.
She loved Almodovar. What was her favourite Almodovar? She loved...
Talk
to Her, when I
talk
meet her.
Talk to Her was the one I always thought she loved. She was
I think we watched probably like Annie Hall or something. I don't know, everything. Like, if I'm going back now, I'm watching films at the moment. There's, you know, it's kind of, that was my whole, like, film education with Kel, like, watching them here. I didn't know anything. And she was showing me so many things.
Kelly and James were kith and kin, both interested in the arts and culture and society. They fell in love in her bedroom upstairs, watching Kelly's box set of all the Curb Your Enthusiasms and endlessly streaming episodes of Seinfeld. They had an easy rapport and snapped together. Around the house, they would crack jokes, make food, and they debated and disagreed. And Kel was uninhibited and natural, frequently showing James affection when I was around. She wasn't bothered that I was there or anything. James I didn't come from a wealthy background, but he was definitely the kind of guy that Kelly went for. Intelligent, articulate, self-aware, and potentially very high achieving. She was attracted to smart, driven men. And during the breaks that she had from James I, of which there would be many, as well as afterwards, she dated stockbrokers. She went out for a time with a world-class mathematician. And her last boyfriend was a multimillionaire hedge fund manager. In 2017, when Kelly was 22, and this was now after she had moved out of here, Kel came around here. She wanted to write this sitcom. But it was basically her life. It was, the main character was her, exactly her. And so in this recording, she and I are talking about scenes that we can find for her character, for the story. And as you'll hear, I keep trying to get her to think of the main character as she, not as I, not as her, to try and think of her as a separate entity. And as you hear, Kel doesn't like that. She's just trying to get her experience out. I guess we would figure out how to fictionalize it all later. In this clip, she's talking about her character's aspirations and relationships. And it really gives you a window into the kind of people that Kelly dated.
I think that she should go on, let's say, two shitty dates. One guy is just a bore.
What kind of a bore is he?
He has nothing to say for himself. He's not very interesting. She has high expectations or high, you know,
demands. What does she expect?
She wants him to be very intelligent, but not pretentious. She wants him to be a lot. Obviously, there's all the good, like, there's all the things, you know, good looking, tall, good career kind of thing. Wants to settle down. There's all those regular things. But then there's like obviously this is me, so it's just like, what that annoys me, it's annoying to keep saying her. What I find that really irritates me when I go on dates with people is that there's like guys who need to, you know, talk constantly. They sort of define themselves by having been to public school.
You've had that, have you?
Oh my god, I've been on a date with an old Etonian, and he needed to mention the fact that he went to Eton like 5 times during the course of the conversation. And it's like, he did a bit of poverty tourism when he was traveling, and he was doing some cleaning work or whatever, just like for some money, because he wasn't taking his parents' money for whatever reason, because he likes to be independent, yeah? And then he was telling me, and so the person found it really funny that an old Etonian was cleaning their flat. It's like, why did you even need to mention to the person who hired you to clean their flat?
That's funny. Does she go with the guy at all?
What?
The old no.
I mean, I did see him again, but I don't want her to be me. I want her to be, like, relentlessly picky.
It was clear within days of Kel arriving here to live in 2012 that she expected a lot of her life. She'd already lost a year of study because of the upheaval in 2009. It emerged that Kel was also quite clear about what the outward shape of her life would be. At age 18, 19, she would talk of her plans to settle down and have children by her mid-20s. She would also marry. She wasn't settled in what career she would follow, but she wanted a decent job that paid well. But in other ways, I started to notice how fixed Kel was and how she seemed to put herself under a lot of pressure. When I spoke with Romina, I remembered how insistent Kel had been when she was doing her university applications in 2013. She would only apply to Russell Group universities, which are like the British Ivy League. And it wasn't that she was wrong to see those as desirable, but it was her fixed and really unyielding view that anything less, a normal university, would be a failure and not worth doing. When she was applying for universities, and it had to be Russell Group, it had to have a certain look to it. And of course, it never worked out that way for her.
It's part of her charm. I think to her, she was attracted to the surface for the sake of status. Do you get what I mean? Yeah, for the sake of appearance. Right. She knew what the value of it was to others. She knew what the value of materials were to others and that it would affect her opportunities in life.
Asaya again.
The way that she spoke and like the things she wanted to do, like learning a language, improving yourself and bettering yourself. I think she was high maintenance, but I think because of how her life was, she wanted to have a different life, which is completely understandable. And our whole world is governed by you have a better life if you are wealthy, if you have money. And I think she maybe strove for it maybe even more than most people because she wanted to live a better life than she had.
Having culture in your life and being cultured was very important to Kel. On the one side, it was a signifier of class and potentially it did offer access to a better life. But that also undermines Kel's genuine love and thirst for it. And the way that she seemed to use it to make sense of her life. She liked words, she liked ideas. She got me interested in Peter Singer and the concept of personhood. And she read endlessly. She loved Haruki Murakami and Thomas Hardy. And she was always going off to galleries and exhibitions. And I've got such fond memories of going to the Barbican to see out-of-the-way things that she wanted to take someone to. We saw a German expressionist film from the 1920s that had just been restored, and Fellini's film 8½. And we occasionally went to gigs, and I mention it because even there you could see her taste was for intelligent and provocative stuff. I remember most brilliantly going with her and James actually to see the Pixies in 2013. And just a few weeks before she died, we went to see Kendrick Lamar at Wembley. When we spoke, James I made a great point about how Kel's active pursuit of culture, like, for example, opera, which she loved, how that might have had a particular appeal for her.
She had a way of dealing with things. She knew where to go, like, in terms of culture and stuff like that. These were the things she took seriously. Mm. Like, so going to the opera might seem this kind of attempt at something when you're quite young or a teenager or early 20s. But she, maybe it did help her in her life. She had a quite dramatic life. And it's sort of, you know, emotions on display. And the literature she read seemed to be that she was, you know, her experience was informed by these things.
Can you say more to that? How do you mean her experience was informed by these things?
Well, it was a kind of life raft. She knew what she... It gave her... She was intelligent.
A framework, in a way, for understanding the craziness, but in a meaningful way, insight into it.
And that people do... If you have insight into it, it almost helps you to understand why she made certain decisions, almost. That she was able to live... I don't know how you define it. At times, recklessly or whatever. Or make decisions that other people don't necessarily understand.
The question of Kel living recklessly and making her own extreme choices is one that would soon become a real worry. But on the surface, she was seeking normality.
I remember she planned to have a meal together. It was a nice idea she had. She put a dinner on, and then I sort of turned up with the friend I was with there, and she was very upset with this fact. See, for some reason, it was impossible for him to get a cab or go home. So he was here during the, and where she set up a candlelit dinner, and it's kind of spoke to that I wasn't being the sort of grown up candlelit version of what our relationship could have been.
I think Kel's reaction to James showing up at the candlelit dinner with someone else was very understandable. But James went on to connect this to an aspect of Kel's behaviour, which many other people spoke about too.
I think she wanted to have this sort of perfected version of a relationship, and sometimes she liked the image of it as well, I think. I think she wanted it to be like a sort of nice picture of we'd met in college and it was going to go a certain way.
How big a thing do you think that was for her? The idea, the myth of it, the fact that if she could make that story work... How big a deal was that for her, do you think?
Yeah, I think she was involved in the story of it. The synchronicity that we turned up at the same college where we hadn't lived here the year before, in that area the year before.
Yeah.
She was the one that was more serious about that it would be going out to dinner and the visuals of a relationship that people have, or just the performative relationship that people have, the way you go out and you do a certain kind of thing. So it would be, so yeah, we would have like date nights and stuff that she would plan. And but it would be all her thing, like going to the opera. It's weird because these are all the smaller, in a smaller version of what she later on kind of, how she ended up having relationships, I suppose. But yeah, it was her that planned to get tickets to the opera and did stuff like this. And her gifts were great. She was nice. It was very cultured. When I went off to uni, she got me a Philip Larkin book about a campus novel. Which speaks to, like, it's not something that everyone would know to find.
Right, that's her. But her relationship with James I would become very intense. They argued frequently, and sometimes the arguments would dominate life downstairs even. It would spill out of the bedroom. And they broke up a lot. But she was always trying to find a way of making things work. She was always trying to understand why he wasn't being considerate in the way she thought was right. And the breakups were very frequent. They were both obstinate people. And when those things happened, Kelly couldn't leave her room. She just stopped being able to function in the outside world. In the autumn of 2013, she's been here for about a year at that point, and the spells in her room now becoming longer, and she started not attending college and missing deadlines.
The relationship between her and James, I think, they were on and off for ages.
Yeah, it was very turbulent.
That was also a kind of wake-up call for me that maybe not everything was going right for her.
So you felt the relationship destabilised her?
So, yes, because it wasn't healthy.
James describes it in more complicated terms than that, with both of them trying to find equilibrium with each other, but often their emotions getting the better of the day.
I think our basic attitude was positive, and there's a lot of memories where I feel like, you know, she's helping me out in terms of we need to plan to study, we need to do whatever it would have been at that time, and I'm trying to do the same, but it's it didn't contribute always in a good way to where we were trying to get, because we were somewhere always between when we were together, sort of being very demanding and being upset, but then when we couldn't be together, that was an equally sort of upsetting thing and an obsession to sort of get it back. You know, it would be dramatic, and instead of people who realise that, you know, there'll be another situation that I'll care about equally. But you don't know that at the time.
In the sense that what you both thought, oh my God, we found each other. Yeah. This is not something.
It was rare. I mean, it was a real thing. But I mean, in terms of how we managed it as well, if we had an argument, then maybe it might affect sort of going to college or college work or something.
Did you find that as well?
Yeah, probably was for that first year. Because you start to care more about this person than the other stuff that's going on. Not that you're intending to care more about this thing or that you'd readily admit it, but it's, you know, it's where your emotions take you.
This is Kelly's school friend, Romina.
She was the kind of person, though, like, chaos was worth a good relationship. You know, it was okay because she had that depth with him, and she did. And a lot of the depth that he gave her, she looked for in other men. He took interest in why she was the way she was.
Mm.
He took interest in more than her, you know, surfacing charm. She was able to open up in all of these ways that she wanted to. She wanted that depth, yeah, exactly. She wanted that relationship, she wanted that warmth. It can happen a lot where the people that you connect with can do nothing for your life, but the people you can do loads for your life, you can't connect with. It ate at her that she created connections with people that drowned her, and then people who lifted her did nothing for her emotionally, drained her, if anything.
The first time I remember Kel identifying as having depression was in an email dispute with her tutor at college, and it had come out in anger. I was involved in that discussion because she was starting to screw up, but when we spoke about it, she said she'd felt it for a long time, but it had been better when she was in Barbados, because partly the sunny weather and partly the very structured days that she had living with Grandma Della. I felt that maybe I'd either not heard it if she'd said it earlier because I wasn't paying proper attention, or maybe she just clammed up. She would later on become someone who spoke about her problems, but for a long time she was quite clammed up. Something deeper was up for Kel, and although I didn't know it at the time, she was actually showing patterns of behaviour that would become magnified and in fact consume her in her last years. Her attachment to these disagreements with James was just too much. And despite the high bar that she was setting for herself as far as her studies and her ambitions to make her way in life, she was easily overcome and she was waylaid by feelings she couldn't control. Kelly severely underperformed in her mock A levels in January 2014. The tipping point came at the beginning of April when the college wrote to her saying they weren't going to put her in for the A level exams. She was seriously underprepared and she seemed unable to focus. But this was a huge blow for Kel, who would now be another year behind everyone and whose plans for university were now further away than ever. I was out of the house that evening and I was just coming home from work when I got a message from Romina saying that Kel had taken an overdose of pills.
Because obviously when she took an overdose, she's just there. She's like messaging me. She's like feeding me this crap. She's just like, I love you, goodbye. You know, it's all going to be dandy. Life's going to be good. And I'm just there like, what the actual fuck is going on? And you're kind of being sucked into this thing where you're like, this stupid girl got me saying goodbye to her. But at the same time, I'm like playing into it. I'm like, who even am I at this point? And so I'm like feeding into the thing. Yeah, good night, sweetheart. I love you. Mate, you can't even imagine how rare it is for somebody to answer their Facebook messages from people they're not friends from.
Is that how you got in touch with me?
Yeah. We weren't even friends on Facebook. I'm like, I'm just going to put this guy's name into the search bar and I'm going to send him a message and it's going to go to a random inbox and we're going to hope that he fucking gets it. All right. But I literally gave myself time. I was just like, if I don't get a response within 10 minutes, 10, 15 minutes, I will send an ambulance to the fucking house. So here I am, you know, and yeah, fucking hell, you've responded. I've explained the situation and you got to take her to hospital. Yes. And I couldn't face her. I couldn't come to the hospital. I was just like, I was really confused over what I had just done. She'd put me on a spot I'd never imagined I'd be in my entire life, where I'd kind of have to say bye to her. I'd essentially betrayed her to save her life. Her mind was irrational, so I decided against it. Which is something I would never do unless I had to, actually.
Being in the ambulance, going with Kel to the Homerton that night was really surreal because I'd been in the same situation with her mother years previously, at least twice, where I'd have to go with her to hospital when she said she'd taken overdoses. I was very worried for Kel, but I was also wondering if this really was her path or whether she wasn't in some messed up way acting out something that she'd been aware of, patterning on her mother. Her relationship with James was turbulent and on and off. So had my relationship with her mother been, and that was the only relationship she'd seen close up. Kel would lock herself away in her room for days. So did her mother. And now this, here I was in an ambulance going to the same hospital for the same reason. Only this time it was Kel on the stretcher. But I also took heart from the fact that Kel had actually contacted quite a few people when she'd taken this overdose. And when I got in, I saw that she already had two friends with her, who I think had come around because they were worried about her. Kel came out of hospital the next morning, and within a few days, she started to be seen by the Complex Anxiety and Depression Unit at the Whittington Hospital. And her recovery, at least on the surface, was fast. She realized that she'd have to take some time off and reconsider her plans, which she did, and she reported that that made her feel a lot happier. And life flowed on quite normally. It's strange to say that now, in light of the fact that Kel's life is now this tragic story. I mean, this is the problem with telling someone's life story, because when you tell someone's story, you sort of inevitably focus on the difficult bits, the struggle of their life, because those are often the most interesting bits of someone's life. But that doesn't really reflect what it was like, because most of the time things were just lovely and boring. Romina made a very good point about that.
I guess at least, you know, us who had had her as part of our daily lives, we just went through it with her as closely as she'd allow us to be. But like I said, it wasn't really compiled actually in front of any of us until we were in court, and I think it was actually really, really overwhelming at that point, because her full experience was suddenly just in your face on paper. Do you know what I mean? It wasn't, oh, this month she's broken her foot, this month she's moving away, this month there's this breakup, this month there's an abortion, this month there's therapy, this month there's a suicide attempt. And it was kind of like looking at it as an outsider.
Do you mean it could have been sort of locked together in a way, do you mean?
Yeah, it was kind of, you know, told in a story, you know, for the sake of the court's understanding. But then what we didn't realise is that now we were being told a story all over again. We realised that we actually didn't think enough of it, because actually all of us as people, if we saw this happening from afar...
Right.
If I sat down and listened to the recordings that you'd taken about someone that wasn't close to me, somebody I didn't know, the things that I would think, like, wow, how did this happen? How, like, this poor girl didn't deserve all that. How the fuck was she gonna get out of it? Would she ever really feel like she was out of it?
When you tell Kelly's life as a story, it's a series of tragic events that are looped together, unified by her end. They're all affected by her end. Even the happy memories are affected by the fact we know what happens. But that wasn't the living of it. In reality, you're on the tightrope walk of all life, where you're making negotiations and trade-offs and investing in the positive and seeing all the small ways, in fact, that Kelly's becoming healthier and more relaxed and more integrated. Going forward, Ken instructed me not to tell Della, or anyone in fact, about her attempt. I accepted that, not without reservation, but ultimately I thought it was Kel's decision, it was Kel's story to tell. And she was, in so many other ways, so competent and insightful that you just thought, well, you know, that you, I guess, wanted to think, well, okay, these things are anomalies, these moments where she slips are the exceptions, not the rule. And in that, I was completely wrong. Also, within about 3 weeks of this attempt, Kelly adopted a couple of cats, Paris and Winter, who she renamed Nix and Bowie. And I thought that was a very positive sign, as well, a sign of Kelly's convalescence. The fact that she wanted to look after things, beings, souls, and nurture them. And I thought it was an investment in life. One of the 7 or 8 recordings I've got of Kel was taken round here in June 2014. And it's utterly unremarkable. It's just her and me sitting around here shooting the breeze. And this would have been about 10, 11 weeks after her attempt. The clip that you heard in the first episode where Kel's talking about social justice warriors, and the one a few later where she's talking about going out on the Tinder date with a guy who's 5'6", they're taken from this conversation. In this clip, Kel's just come back from visiting her friend Christina at uni in Lancaster.
But seriously, all the Northern accents in Lancaster were so funny. Oh, it was so funny. I really had fun. and like, loads of Christina's friends were just like normal from other places, and they just kept saying things, and we really giggled. Just everything's funny in a Northern accent. Are you making fun? Where are you from? From Huddersfield. Anyway, sorry. No, Christina's been there too long. She said castle.
Oh, I sometimes say castle. Not castle, but I say Newcastle.
Why?
Well, I don't know, if it just feels right to say. I really like Newcastle. I feel it's the one way I feel identified with it in language, is to call it Newcastle. Oh, no, Newcastle, yeah. I've spent time there. I get to call it Newcastle.
Newcastle.
I don't know why it is. I really like the Geordies. I think they're great.
The
worst?
Yeah.
No, the best.
They're hilarious, but they're not.
And kind of sexy in a way.
No, they're not.
Men and women. I think the male accent, the Geordie accent, is really sexy.
Jesus Christ, watch out, Mrs. Noble.
Yeah.
Oh my God, I'm a cab driver on the way from Christina's house to the coach station. He was funny. Northerniest bloke in the world as well. He kept making loads of silly jokes. That text of PISS that. And he's the best person I met for like a month or two.
You look at it now and you think, how could things return to normal? Kel's friend Ollie describes how little impact Kel's attempt of 2014 had on her friendships and the way people dealt with her.
I knew she'd had an attempt on her life whilst probably somewhere around 2013-14 while I was at uni.
It was April 2014. And how did you know about that?
She fucking texted me telling me she loved me in the middle of the night, and I had an awful feeling. And then fucking the next day it turned out she had had an attempt. That was all I kind of knew of it. To be honest, I knew our friendship group, a lot of people had attempts. It's very common in my family. You must just take it on and just move on with it. Like, you didn't really think too much more of it. But Yeah, I really don't know what else. What was the question?
No, that was the question. I mean, how aware were you of her struggling with her mental health over the last few years?
I knew she had that attempt, but other than that, I wasn't too much. I kind of knew she struggled, like, in this, but I don't think it was like a... I'm trying to get back to, like, thinking of, like, the way me and my mother would talk about her, and the fact that, like, my mum's saying she can draw parallels in how Kelly was with her. I was kind of aware of that, but I didn't think it was necessarily anything like... I think people have mental issues, but it may not be... I think at certain times it's more so drawn to the forefront of their life and kind of becomes more overbearing. Hmm. I didn't think Kelly was like that at all.
Ollie's right. That's how she seemed. She didn't seem like she was like that at all. Whatever struggles she might be facing, Kelly also was competent. She sounded competent. She could talk about where she was at, and she was very clear about wanting to seek help. And as you can hear from the two clips that we play throughout the series taken in 2014, she was engaged with her life. She seemed to appreciate it. What none of us appreciated was how much she kept hidden. 4 years later, after her death, in all the flurry of paperwork that came out around her trial and inquest, we saw hospital and medical reports that showed she'd been attempting and thinking about suicide more often than she let on. In addition to the self-harming that had started when she was 11, it turned out that she had twice overdosed on paracetamol during the period where she was living with her mother and me at Petherton Road in 2008 and 2009. As a sidebar, I read in the notes that I, in fact, reported one of those incidents at the time to a professional. And I'll be honest with you, I'd forgotten that I'd even known about that. And just reading that jogged the memory, and it shows to me in retrospect how I minimize pill taking and attempts at suicide myself. Because why would I not have remembered that? It also turns out that she had taken another lesser overdose a few months earlier in 2013. That was since coming back from Barbados and living at Petherton Road. And she hadn't reported that to professionals at the time. And that was something that no one in her circle had known about. Della and I found out at the inquest that Kelly said that she had been sexually assaulted / raped at one point during her time in Barbados. That depends on which report you're reading. And she also said that it was something that hadn't traumatized her, that wasn't a core issue for her. It was not something she claimed had affected her. Much later, when Ollie came around here to do our conversation for this, I found out that she'd told him at the time or around the time, but I'm not aware of anybody else knowing. But I'll say this to anybody who is listening to this, who's either in Kel's position or is trying to help somebody who's in Kel's position. Because in all of the reading that I've done about suicide since Kelly died, the one thing, the most predictable marker, the most reliable indicator that connects people who successfully kill themselves is a previous suicide attempt. And not including the incidents of self-harming, this would have been Kelly's fourth. In the summer months of 2014, Kelly was reframing her life. She had now lost 2 years of education, and she still had no A-level qualifications. She felt the gap with her peers acutely. She felt that they were all moving on to higher education or starting with their careers, and she was still stuck. She developed a love of cuisine, and at home she was a great cook. She wanted to go to culinary school, so we investigated 2-year diplomas, which she could do whilst she retook her A-levels at night school. These were all affordable options for me, although I was lucky enough quite a few years ago to inherit enough money just to buy this flat. That aside, I've been self-employed in the arts for years and have a complete artist's income. It's really feast and famine. However, Kel had her eyes on the cordon bleu. It was a world-renowned school. They had courses starting up all the time, and employment prospects were excellent upon graduation. But it was very expensive. They wanted £17,000 up front for a 6-month course, and I couldn't afford it. Also, employability is generally good in that industry. Chefs and kitchen staff get work. And even though we didn't have much money here, our home was relaxed and big, and I thought that Kel could just do with a couple of more years finding her feet. and building up her sense of self. You know, which is all very well when you're in your late 40s and you've learned that you have to have patience. But if you're 19, 20, and you're wired the way she was, that's not what you want to hear. But that's how we left it. And in the interim, over the autumn, Kelly said that she'd got quite a good paying job as a PA for a writer who lived over in West London. But that would turn out to be a lie. Meanwhile, Kel's on-off relationship with James was becoming increasingly turbulent. There were so many bonkers arguments between them around the house. I remember bringing a new girlfriend to the house at the end of 2013, and she was freaked out that all we could hear downstairs was Kel and James stomping around upstairs having some argument or other. I remember another time when Kel noisily evicted James. He'd been staying for a couple of weeks, and Kelly took his bags and stuck them at the door and told him to fuck off. And I was just working downstairs in the kitchen with a comedian, Sean Walsh, and we were both, you know, this whole thing was just being played out without any regard for us. And there was another time where, during an argument, Kel had stopped James leaving her room. So the only way he could get out was via the upstairs bedroom window. And he just slowly descended to the ground floor, gripping the bars and external stairs the best he could. There'd also been an occasion where James's mother and I had had to become involved and lay down the law when Kel had crossed the line. And then there was another time when I'd had to step in and ban James from the house after he had. This is Romina.
I feel like I really need to say Kel had way too many chances to give, right?
What do you mean by that? I don't get it.
I mean, it started with her mum, but she did it all through her life. She gave loads of people ridiculous amounts of chances. In every way, you know, from people, you know, hurling physical abuse at her to just the amount of weight she'd put on their opinions, the same as she did with her mother, the amount of approval she'd want from specific people.
I remember the last time that Kel and James fought, and it was absolutely it was over for good, and that was September 2014. But despite that, in the months that followed, despite being really clear in her mind at the time why it was over and why it couldn't continue, she clearly pined for it. There's a little moment on a recording taken here in December 2014. Kel and James have been apart for about 3 months at this point, and it's Kelly, me and Romina.
You know what, I think you know, this is the first Christmas that I won't have a boyfriend since I was about 14. Mm.
Yeah, no, it is miserable. I'm spending the Christmas with James because of it.
I kind of... No, I'm not upset about it. It's quite the contrary. I'm fucking chuffed.
And also, yeah, we were going to do a couple's Halloween costume and everything.
No, you're going... You're... What? Okay, I don't want you thinking that we're agreeing on that because I don't feel that way.
What? You don't want to do couples Halloween
costumes? No, I'm fucking happy to be single.
No, I'm not happy.
Yeah, I know, I got that
feeling.
You
got this nice, you got the cute little... I know I've complained to you about this on the floor constantly. But fuck Charlie Boozek! How dare she? I'm a nice person.
You know what? Yeah, there are a million different types of nicety in this fucking world, and I don't know why you're obsessed with the ones that come from being...
In one relationship, with another, a little, 2 months later,
it was fucking.
No, because he's nice.
What? Loads of people are nice. There's 7 billion population.
Despite the history, in the new year of 2015, Kel and James were back in touch, and they were looking to see if they could find a way forward. This is James.
She'd got back in touch. And had, after the breakup and lack of contact for a few months, and said she, like, it basically turned out that she would visit Glasgow. There was no talk of it being a relationship. I think the aim was that we might end up going out again, but it was very much testing it. And by going out again, that would be like, you know, after university, so in a few years. So it was an aim for a longer term thing, recognizing that we're going to be in different cities and doing different things for a while. So just see if we can kind of vaguely get along and see what happens.
This was somewhat background to me at the start of 2015 because my own personal life had taken its own chaotic turn. I'd just recently had a son with a very new girlfriend, and having a child had accelerated the conversation I was having with her. And it was a Saturday morning in the spring of 2015. I heard James and Kel were arguing in the bedroom upstairs. And James then came downstairs carrying Kelly's laptop. And it was open and he showed me what he was looking at. And it was a profile, an escort profile. And Kelly's face wasn't visible in the pictures, but it was her. At least one of the pictures had been taken in her bedroom. And it turned out that she had been working for a few months as an escort. James was understandably mortified. And while it was a measure of them both that they would go on to become good friends, their relationship didn't survive this.
This was something that she had hid from basically all her friends. So it was completely cut off from other people. You know, I didn't know about it. So I said that I decided I would tell you as to have someone else aware, because I'm no longer involved.
Oh, so when you said to her when you found out upstairs you were going to go down and tell me, you told her before you told me that you were going to tell me?
I mean, obviously that was just one of the things that I said, but I think that's how I left it. It's probably like the last thing. It was to leave it with you, and that was an equal, it was to be hidden from any of her friends and basically anyone she knew. The only clarity was that we found out at the same moment in that I told you and then left for a long time. So that's where my knowledge of the situation kind of ends. But clearly it was upsetting that I would know. But also it was quite upsetting, I think, that you knew. I think part of our plan was to keep it hidden from basically anyone.
Kelly wouldn't talk to me for days. When I finally got her to speak, she explained that she'd decided to go alone and find a quick way of raising the money to attend the Cordon Bleu. It turns out, and I only found this out in the conversation that you're about to hear, that the only other person she'd told about this was Romina.
Why do you think that she did sex work?
She needed money and she knew she was attractive. She needed fucking a lot of money really quickly. I think that was her ticket out. I think she was just like, I'm gonna do this and it's gonna fucking make me, kind of thing. Because after she died and everyone was discussing her estate in court, I actually stood back and thought, fuck me. Fuck me, this girl must have thought that she literally has to create everything by herself. And I think for that, she kind of made the really rash decision of, it's not going to get better by itself. Do you know what I mean? I need to do something insane to jump this
but
level.
But don't you think that her desire, for example, to go to Cordon Bleu, whereas what she could have done would have been to do a 2-year course, stay settled.
That's just not something Kel was going to do. You wanted
Why
to be,
not?
Because if she was going to do it, she wanted to, if she was going to do anything, she was going to do it, you know, with a silver fucking lining. She was going to do it, like, you know, it was going to be 5-star or fuck all.
What does that mean? You mean
the
course?
Because
it was her way of saying,
exactly.
Here's the Russell Group of cookery school.
Legit. Literally.
Right.
She didn't want to be a slave to money. She wanted to jump that level. She was trying to, you know, jump to the middle class. How the fuck am I going to hop this? I need a good certificate. Do you know what I mean? There are no silver spoons in my mouth. She had to put one there. She wasn't willing to live simple. I'm not saying that she couldn't have. Yeah, you're right. She could have fucking got. She wasn't willing to live simple. She was willing to do insane fucking shit to improve her life. And that's why I could never actually say anything to her. I don't know. Call me overly liberal. Call me a dickhead. Say whatever. But when I understood the fact that she solely wanted to do better in life and she felt. What was I supposed to say to her? I didn't have money to give her. I didn't have a job to offer her that was going to give her enough money to save quick enough. Do you know what I mean? 17, 20 grand, whatever, is not fucking cheap. I'm not, I can't pull that out of my ass, and I don't know anyone who can. Mm. And she's just trying to achieve something. And bless her cotton socks, how many fucking people can you say this about, okay? They get into prostitution with a fucking goal, okay? Hit their goal and leave and carry on with their fucking life, all right? She wasn't a fucking junkie. She wasn't fucking nothing, all right? None of whatever you might stereotype her to be. And she definitely wasn't just, you know, making cash off a fucking cheap thrill. It was...
And what happened? Did she tell you that she was doing it? Did you know? Do you know that she was thinking about it? Before
she
started.
She told me she was planning it. She's like, I've got myself a hoe phone. She's like, proper going into it. I'm like, what the actual fuck, mate? But yeah, no, she told me she was going to do it. I was so dumbfounded. I've never known anyone else to do sex work. Definitely not any of my friends or anything. I will never actually really know what she went through, how it must have felt. There were times she'd give me details and I was just like, oh my God. Like, usually out of... She became really desensitized. Mm. I felt like the very sensitive child I knew that was terrified of feet and was put off by feet was suddenly knew people who are into scat. And I'm like, so a man will pay you to take a shit on him? And she's like, yeah. She did what she felt she had to do. With, you know, careful thought. Maybe insane thought, but carefully insane thought. Absolutely fascinated with her level of organization. I don't think I'm the only one that said this about her. Like, she had a separate phone. I can't imagine why she kept the money. She said she had a separate account or whatever, PayPal system. I can't remember what the fuck she said, but there was a, you know, safe payment system through the internet, whatever. And I'm like, you've got all this in different places. Is there cash in different places? Do you know what I mean? Because everyone's paying the same either. So she's got all this ridiculous system put in place, okay? She's like, you know, high tech fucking,
wow.
Yeah, she's her own boss. Like, she's not just a prostitute. She's a prostitute, she's a pimp, she's an accountant. It's a fucking madness, mate. Because obviously James is still in her life at this point, so she's got this her phone hidden in the system. Like, this is skilled work. Yes. This is not suck a dick for my fix. I feel the need to really, you know, emphasize that this wasn't basic hoeing. This was a complex financial plan that was gonna get her out of a hole. I would have genuinely told you if I thought there would have been anything you could have fucking done. I just thought it wouldn't have made it any better to rock her living situation. Do you know what I mean? I didn't know how you would take it. I didn't know if you'd be able to handle it at all. It wasn't about giving you an opportunity to help. You weren't supposed to get an opportunity to help. She made that decision that she was going to handle it for whatever reason. And she was going to handle it in that way. Saving this money and somehow getting into this school and you somehow never fucking asking,
how are you doing, Kel?
Where'd you get 20 grand?
Because it's not like we haven't had the conversation about Paul Dunbar and gone, this is,
Oi, Kel,
I can't do this.
Get 20 grand? Yes. You know, I don't know what the fuck that end bit was going to be about, but that was the intention. The idea wasn't even to come to you, Phil. You found out by accident.
Hmm.
I was really worried as well when she said they found out, especially with James and everything. I was just like, oh my God, is everything okay?
I was incredibly shocked that Kel had been doing this, that she'd been doing this so secretly. It changed a way in which I understood her, you know, her ability to maintain that facade. She said that she'd never brought it to the house. I was very worried, obviously, about the impact on her and how could that even be an option? And she said that she didn't have a certain hang-up, I suppose, that she felt a lot of people had around sex. She saw it, she could do it quite easily. She said she didn't have any difficulty with the work and it was the quickest way she could get to earn her money. And I implored her to stop it and to look at another way. And I said, what if I don't support this? What if I can't do it? And she said, I'll just move out and I'll do it somewhere else. I'm going to do this. Not I've got to do this, I'm going to do this. So I raised some money for her.
I think of her total, I gave her in the end about a half of what she had left. And I lived with the fact that she was doing it for 3 or 4 months. She took a break because she was, she started a relationship with a guy and she didn't want to be cheating on him. And it's the most, you know, difficult thing to have managed with her. She swore me to secrecy as she swore Romina to secrecy. Of course, Romina would never have told me. And I made the mistake, in fact, of telling my girlfriend about it at the time because I just needed some support. I didn't know what the fuck to do with this information. I called her on the day that I found out about it, and Kel hadn't even told me not to tell anyone yet, although I knew that Kel would have hated that I'd told my girlfriend. But I didn't know who else I could share that with. And we'd had a child together, and she seemed to be, at that time, a very reasonable person. And weirdly, my girlfriend wasn't shocked about it. She said that the most important thing was to find out why she was doing it, what her aim was in doing it, and did she have an exit plan? And if that was the case, could it be managed? And I'm not saying that it was her idea that I should find a way of living with it, but she helped me find a framework. But it was a huge mistake to talk to her, because later on, although not much later, because it didn't last long, my girlfriend became my wife. And we ended up divorcing very quickly and very acrimoniously. And after that, my now ex-wife then went to Kelly's mother and told her that Kelly had escorted. I don't know what she told her, but that became the basis of the mother's claim that Kelly had in fact been escorting since just after she'd come to live with me. Then that Kelly carried on escorting until she died and it had fucked her up. And that was nobody's understanding of it. She stopped. She, in fact, came to me at the beginning of the autumn and said she had gone past a point. She said she didn't want to do it anymore. And she wasn't able to handle it like she thought she could. And so from there, I was able to raise some money and give it to her and get her out of it. She put it down and didn't return to it and wasn't interested in it and realized what the consequences could be for her if she carried on doing it, I think. But it was very difficult to live with, and I agreed with her philosophically. I understood why it didn't have to be a problem, and I didn't see an issue with women earning their money that way, or men. But I have massive regrets about not intervening further and stopping it dead in its tracks. And it's really embarrassing for me to even talk about the fact that I knew about it. But that's a subject that we'll return to, because I think this aspect of her life and the fact that she did it, I think, is really important. And I think it has great bearing on the kind of person she was. So Kelly had delayed her entry to the Cordon Bleu, but she joined the school in January 2016. And that's where she met Lisa. To Lisa, Kel told a story about how she'd raised the money for her tuition, which was the same as the story she'd told me in the autumn of 2014.
She told me when I met her, that was actually the first time we went for drinks. She told me a story that just did not sound right at the time. She told me that she was a secretary for one of her friends that was a writer, I think, and that he was just paying her lots and lots of money, and that's how she afforded it. And it's just like, at the time, all the people's stories from the money that's around you there, it's just like you kind of take it all for granted.
One of the big questions about Kelly's sex work, of course, is how it affected her. What did it do to her mental state? Lisa describes here a correspondence that she had with Kel, which would have taken place well over a year after Kelly had stopped escorting.
I didn't know about what Kelly had been doing. And she had shown a very strong respect and understanding of sex workers, but she hadn't told me that she had done that herself. The way she spoke about it was very much sex work is legitimate work and there's nothing wrong with it. And it was very pro sex work, not pro her. It was just, if you enjoy it, you enjoy it. And there's nothing wrong with it. Do you know what I mean? It was very in support of everything.
Yes.
I never got the impression from her that she thought it was something that had ruined her or any negative thoughts towards sex work.
No, me neither, but I don't think it helped. And I think...
I can understand that.
She said the thing that was upsetting her after a few months, and she said, I just don't want to carry on doing this, it's depressing, was the having to kiss them and how sleazy some of them were and just having to just see just some of these men, they were just awful, and she didn't want to do that, and
as much as she was a sexually liberated young woman, and she enjoyed her sex life, she was very picky about who she dated. And so loosening that can't have been easy at all.
In January 2016, Kelly finally began her studies at the Cordon Bleu. It would end up being a year of great change in Kel's life. At the end of it, she would have to move out of here before it was her time to, and she'd find herself in another complex, turbulent love affair, one which would turn out to be her last. But in September 2016, Kelly graduated from the Cordon Bleu. I felt honoured when Kel wanted me to be her guest, and I know I was the proudest person in that room. I was proud of her because she had accomplished her goal and because she belonged, finally, to that class of qualified and employable people, but also because I knew that Kel had sacrificed more than anyone else to earn her place in that room.
Peace of mind, I'm behind on what's really important. My mind is really distorted. I find